This meeting of the Riley Conservation Commission is hereby called to order under the authority of Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 131, Section 40, Town of Riley Wetlands Protection Bylaw and Stormwater Management and Erosion Bylaw. Notice is given, both video and audio recording we made of this meeting. The agent will now call roll for attendance.
Thank you. Dave Delmonico, absent. Bob Garner.
Here.
Judy Keys, absent. Sam Strife.
Here.
Arthur Page.
Yep.
Kirk Turner.
Here.
Howard Vogel.
Here.
We have a quorum present, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, the first thing we have right here would be payroll and or vendor bills.
Definitely some of those. Request for reimbursement for an adapter we needed to purchase to get a monitor to work. It was very slow billing. That was actually from a while ago, back in December sometime. I'm sorry, if you could review the backup invoice. And then we have a request for reimbursement of some postage coming out of the notice of intent funds. So it's a wetlands notice of violation. And then that's the backup receipt for that. And finally, I forgot the little sign here sticker, but we got another postage expenditure.
Bring us to the minutes, and we'll do it all each three separate. I just want to remind you people that on the February 14th one, that is raising its head again tonight. That was the one where we were action was being taken against that. But as so we'll talk about the February 14th, 2017 first. Is everybody get a chance to review that?
There were amended ones, right? Is there some amendments?
Yeah, just a second.
Yeah. Let me catch up.
Okay, for February 14th, yes, on the second page at the top, as we were continuing this discussion on the Prospect Hill Access Road project, it was pointed out to us that we had some less than specific verbiage in there. So Agent Baselak advised the commission that no application or other documentation had been filed concerning specific stream blockages and flooding, period. The next edit is the next sentence. Mr. Conley advised the commission that he would submit documentation once the matter was on the agenda. Yeah, they just made the meaning clearer and it flow in natural progression.
Anybody have anything else? Do I hear a motion to accept that as amended? Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Abstain. I wasn't there.
Yes.
I'm abstaining. But you?
Yes.
I think I could technically vote one way or the other.
Yeah, as an administrative, as it's an administrative act, yes, you could.
Since it doesn't affect the vote, I will abstain.
May 5th, 2015. Oops, excuse me.
Just a second. Not the quickest light bulb here. So that means four yeas, and I'm sorry, who made the motion?
I did.
And who seconded?
I did.
Okay.
That brings us to the May 5th, 2015. Does everybody have a chance to read that? Any problems? Questions?
There was one edit to that. On the second page where we were talking about land off of Stackyard Road owned by U.S. Fish and Wildlife, and we were entertaining a motion, a request from Marine Biological Labs to move their atmospheric station. The following sentence was revised. DEP gave the opinion that if permission was received from the landowner and the Mass Department of Fish and Game, as well as assurance that the new location would not cause any additional disturbance, the commission could approve the instrument tower relocation.
Do I hear a motion to, anybody have any further questions or? Do I hear a motion to accept that as now written?
So moved.
All in favor?
Second?
Second, second. I both at once.
Okay.
Oh, aye.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Janice, thank you. Okay.
The next is the May 26, 2015. Anybody have any questions? Everybody get a chance to read that? Any questions?
This is the open meeting part.
This is the regular, no, there was. Commissioner Turner contacted me this afternoon and suggested the following addition to page 4 of 4. In regards to the go into executive session to consider the purchase, exchange, lease, or value of real property, if the chairman declares that an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the negotiating position of the public body, period. The suggestion, which I think was very good from Commissioner Turner, was to add the following. Chairman Watson declared that this was the case in this situation.
Okay. Everybody, do I hear a motion to accept that as revised?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you very much.
That brings us to the review of the draft. You all have a copy of right here, fiscal year 18.
Okay, our proposed budget is not substantially changed. Non-union employees receiving a wage increase as follows: 1% cost of living increase, 1.25% step increase. Let's see, union employees referred to the AFSCME memorandum of agreement and FY18 compensation schedule. As we had first done, there is a request in here that I wish the commission would entertain for a portion of the 16 hours for the secretary's weekly time, that 6 hours be authorized to, that those wages come out of the notice of intent monies. We had previously made a decision that approximately 6 hours out of her 16 hours of weekly duties would be directly attributable to administration of the Wetlands Protection Act, and therefore the commission is allowed to authorize the use of the dedicated notice of intent funds that are in a separate account, that those can be utilized. And that was also the part of the presentation we made to the FinCom committee for the initial authorization of restaffing this position. And they had asked when we made that presentation if the commission was going to continue that contribution towards her wages. And at the time, over a year ago, the indication was yes. And we still have the financial wherewithal to do that. We have a balance of approximately $43,000.
I was going to say, what is your holding balance? Okay.
Yeah. So
and what has that?
So there
has that gone up or down or?
Gone up a little bit. I mean,
yeah.
We do not expend anywhere near the amount of notice of intent monies that come in, but we do try to appropriately use them for the postage, for because the postage gets very expensive for sending things certified now and stuff. So, so we do make it a continual practice to use that, and it is a portion to some of our.
What else do you use that money for?
Some of it goes towards communication.
Signage. Is it where are you taking the signage and stuff?
We have some land management funds that we have utilized some of that, but we actually haven't. Again, we don't make relatively significant expenditures.
No.
To be quite honest with you, and we have, well, anyway. In terms of running the department, though, we have a very light footprint, and so the apportionment out of the NOI funds would be a request for $5,114.64, which I think I rounded off to a proposed letter, if you would so authorize it, to go to the selectman that requests $5,200.
Okay, so we need a motion to, accept this? Second?
Second.
In favor? Aye.
Aye.
Just go back to your question then. So this particular fund, does that tend, after expenses going out each year, does that tend to stay flat year to year after, in other words?
I'm sorry, the notice of intent funds?
Yeah, so was that the answer, is that basically that's gotten to a certain level, whatever goes in any given year, we're pulling out about the same amount, so it stays plus or minus?
No.
Or is it going down?
Well, okay.
Because we never pulled out of this before at this size,
right?
Right,
yes, yes.
Yeah.
In the past, the commission, when I first came here, the commission made a practice of seeking to get the authorization from the selectmen for chunks of $3,000. They hadn't tracked what they were actually expending, and they actually had like it stacked up, which. So for a number of years, I just kind of coasted, and then got us back down to the portion that when we track it and when we get low, we ask, we go through, I come to the commission, and then I go to the selectman with a request. There was I believe when I was bumped up from 30 hours, was it? Or from 25 hours to 32 hours. One of the steps.
I remember that.
One of the steps the commission authorized what, so that was probably 8 years ago, and that was kind of the first time that a significant amount, i.e. $6,000 or something like that, or $8,000 was utilized. Now with the secretary, this will be the second time as an annual occurrence that we've looked at roughly $5,000 approximately.
See, we used to call it the revolving account at the cemetery.
This is totally different than a revolving account. This is actually mandated by the state.
Oh, it is? Okay.
Yes. That commissions have these monies that are dedicated, and they cannot be mixed in with general fund monies, and they do not have to be authorized by town meeting. Now, the revolving funds do need to be authorized by town meeting vote, and do not have to go through, I think, annual reauthorization.
What does Hayward use your fee account for?
We're on the record. I would prefer not to answer that question.
Okay, well,
without a vote of the full Hayward Commission, I would like, before we leave this subject, I'd just like to say that you know, having sat on this commission for over 25 years and have seen the growth and the responsibilities that have accrued to this commission, and have seen the competence and the time involvement that Mr. Bazelak has put into this work, that I don't think a 1% raise adequately reflects his performance, and he deserves a lot more than that. I understand the aspects, the political aspects of town budgets and all of that, and we sort of have to live with that, but I still think that Brett's outstanding performance over the years, continuing every year, deserves more than he gets.
I have to constantly chase him out of here on Fridays.
And,
not all the time on Fridays.
I look for you this Friday, but I didn't find it. Thought I could sneak in.
I believe I do appropriately need a confirming motion for the request to go to the Board of Selectmen to seek the authorization of that $5,200.
Do I hear such a motion?
I would just get that.
Yeah, we're going to vote on that.
Oh, I thought you were voting on the budget.
We voted on the budget.
We didn't as with that in it.
Yeah, right. Oh, you combined them. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
All right, so I'll... Okay.
Just for clarity's sake, let's revisit it.
But if you'd like to do
I'm
separate...
I move to approve the budget, including this $5,000 item.
Yeah.
Yes.
I second the second vote.
You second it? All in favor?
So right. Strike out the first.
Right. Well, I'm just doing them both.
We're doing them both. We can strike out the first
I think
vote.
We covered all the bases.
So before we leave from that,
I
request
Chairman Lee to find the first one was just for the $5,000.
Thank you very much.
Now, on the 7:45, do you want me to just read that?
Yes, please.
Okay, that brings us to the 7:45. That is a continued notice of intent to 305 Newburyport Turnpike, map 17, parcel 20, lot 47, filed by Edward Surratt Prime Realty Trust, proposed construction of a 3,640 square foot commercial building with 11,400 square foot extended parking area, grading, utilities, stormwater facilities, 3,800 square foot wetlands filling and replication within the bordering vegetated wetlands, BVW, and the 100-foot buffer.
I have an email communication.
You want me to read this?
Yes, please.
Dear Brent, having reviewed the 2017 meeting schedule, I now request to continue the NOI hearing for Prime Realty Trust to March 28th. This would allow us for continued interaction with the Planning Board Stormwater Consultants. Thank you, Bill Madden. Do I hear a motion to?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. I see the parties are here for the next one. If you'd want, we can start that now.
Yeah.
Okay.
Go ahead.
That brings us for the 8 p.m., which is new notice of violation for 982 Lot 1 Havel Street, map 4, parcels 19 and Lot 9, Lot 1, owned by Sharif Abu Dara, trustee for Spring Realty Trust. Under the Massachusetts Wetland Protection Act, the Town of Raleigh Wetlands Protection Bylaw, possible altering by clearing, grading, earth disturbance within 100 foot of a buffer zone of an isolated vegetating bordering vegetated wetlands and DEP approved groundwater protection zone 2. Under the Town of Raleigh Stormwater Management and Erosion Control Bylaw, possible failure to install effective erosion controls after disturbing the earth and clearing the vegetation. Failure to effectively control and prevent sediment from entering a public right-of-way and abutting property, disturbing over 20,000 square feet of surface area without a valid stormwater management permit.
Okay.
Other than that, it's all
right. Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Excuse me?
I'm sorry.
What is it you want me to do with this?
This is a letter I am submitting to the commission.
Okay. I haven't read, no, I will not, no, I cannot initial it. That would imply some type of authorization. I will mark it received.
Received, yeah, that is it.
Since I haven't had an opportunity to read it, I would prefer to be conservative.
Thank you.
Sorry. Unless, of course, that gets me a $100,000 life insurance policy.
Now, is that the plan?
Yes.
The Apple Associates?
Well, I decided to put everything in the letter. Yeah. However, let me explain what we were doing.
Yeah.
Before you proceed, I think it's valid if I offer an opinion to the commission in regards to this.
Please.
Notice the violation is issued under both the Wetlands Protection Act and the Town of Raleigh's Wetlands Protection Bylaw. I tried to explain to Mr. Abu Zara that the issue was not just the isolated vegetated wetland, nor the existence of the 100-foot buffer zone of the isolated vegetated wetland, and the 100-foot buffer zone from bordering vegetated wetlands that extends from the adjacent parcel owned by Mr. Carpeno at 970 Hill Street. If the commission will bear with me just a second, I tried to educate Mr. Abu Zara that all of these parcels are entirely within the delineated
groundwater protection area zone two, which extends across Haverhill Street. This is 982. This is lot one, doesn't have any street address. This is also .992, and this is lot 1000 Haverhill Street, corresponding to assessors, all map four. One's parcel lot two, another part is parcel 20 lot two, another is parcel lot 19, and the final one is parcel 19 lot one.
Which one's 982?
Ed Capetta?
No. This is 982.
Yeah, that's 982. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
And that has the
existing structure.
Abandoned single-family home and detached garage that front on Haverhill Street.
Okay.
Adjacent to it is lot one that has no street number because it doesn't have a structure on it. That seems to correspond, based to the aerial photos, as to where the large excavator is parked and where the crushed stone entrance exit pad is.
So that's a very narrow lot.
Yes, yeah, very narrow, all the way back.
Okay.
Yeah. So just returning to the letter that we've been initially given, the town's wetlands protection bylaw identifies the groundwater protection area zone two as a resource area that is regulated and under the jurisdiction and oversight of the Raleigh Conservation Commission for anything that would alter, dredge, fill, or remove that area. So I just wanted to frame that in reference that this letter does, even though I tried to explain that to Mr. Abizarra, this letter makes no mention of that resource area, which is jurisdictional for the commission. Sorry, didn't mean to interrupt you, but I think that's important.
I'm very sorry if I missed that part.
So
all that, all those properties are within zone two.
The zone two.
Within zone management. Two. Yeah. Stormwater management.
Right. No, not stormwater management. No. Groundwater protection area.
Groundwater protection. Okay, thank you.
So they have.
But yes, there is a separate notice of violation issued because under the stormwater management and erosion control bylaw, any activity which has the propensity to create erodible soils that could leave the property, enter the public right-of-way, enter an abutting property, or enter a wetlands or waterway, all require the use of appropriate erosion control, as well as the fact that activities that exceed 20,000 square feet in disturbance are required to actually file and receive a stormwater management permit.
Okay, do you have such a permit?
Let me explain.
He may not have heard you.
Do you have a stormwater management permit?
Can I say something? Could you speak higher because it doesn't hear well? Okay.
If you speak louder. let me speak about this.
He's asking you a question.
We have this area.
Yeah.
Permitted in 2007. This was permitted in 1999.
Yeah.
And this is ABZ storage.
Yeah.
And we have a fence here. What we were doing in this area, we just wanted to grade this one under the 1999 permit, which was a grandfather before this area became zone two. And what we were doing, we were grading this area here. Now what happened was this, we were to come to this area, we were coming this way. And Mr. Bezlak, when he sent me this notice, I called him and he came and he said we would like to have stones here so that we will prevent dirt to come into this field, which we did already.
Actually, I mentioned to him that the size of the stone put there was inadequate to fill the duty of getting knocking in, so I suggested to him that.
Now, while we were coming here, all our work was this way, one here, which is far away from this wetland. But our question was 1999, that area was not zoned zone two. It was something else. I mean, we were allowed to do the work here. So we thought we were grandfathered here, and we were. Now, what happened while we were coming here, there was loam all around this area. And we thought instead of coming in and out with the car, the loam was coming here, so we piled it all, we collected it in one pile here. And there were some bushes, we put them here, and that was his, you're right.
Right.
Yeah, so when Mr. Baselak called me, we came here, and he told us to put erosion control here,
yeah,
and erosion control here,
right,
and we did.
Yeah.
Now, we answered all his requirements here. Now, the only question we have is, as you notice here, when this plan was made in 2007, there was no isolated wetland. And if we look at the next plan here, where we have elevation, where we have elevation, as you notice here, we have a big hill,
right,
in this area. That's why we couldn't go from here to here in the past. We graded this area, and we collected this. This is the wetland here, and this is the buffer zone, 100 feet. We have 46 feet here. Now, from here to here, all the way, our neighbors here, mm-hmm, have a driveway,
yeah,
which made it higher than it was before. And if you look here, the elevation is 76 feet. The elevation here is 72 feet. Water used to go in its natural course to here. When they did the driveway all the way to here, they raised it, I don't know how many feet high, well, they stopped the water and imprisoned the water in this area. And of course, at the time when the gentleman here was permitted his work, we said that there is no isolated wetland, and this was done in 1999. And it was permitted here. And we have all of these signatures for that. So
unfortunately for Dr. Abu Zahra, that's immaterial.
Well, that is
and there is no grandfathering under the town's wetlands protection bylaw. There is no grandfathering under the stormwater and erosion control bylaw except for valid existing permits for development activity, of which there are none that have been presented to our office or that the planner is aware of for these particular lots. There is a plan of record for ABC, mm-hmm, self-storage, mm-hmm, and the development of that particular parcel. But most of the activities that are cited in the notice of violation have to do with activities that are not part of the development plan for that planning board special permit or whatever it was. And in fact, this is the edge of the disturbance at the most southerly, mm-hmm, and I'm sorry, it's a little hard to see, but there's a pink flag right there. Delineating the edge of the isolated vegetated wetland, which based on the most recent information provided to the commission in regards to the permit request for Dunn Landscaping.
Yeah, I recall
that. I think he's at 968, and this is 970.
Mm-hmm.
This is the property line here. Here's the isolated vegetated wetland area. I believe I'm showing you the possibility of one or either of those two flags. The edge of disturbance is 18 feet. In this picture right here, you can see two of the flags, which correspond to these two flags at the end of the isolated vegetated area. Irrespective of whether that isolated vegetated wetlands area is there, the 100-foot buffer zone from bordering vegetated wetlands that is located on this portion of Mr. Carpeno's property at 970 projects a 100-foot buffer zone that extends out to here.
Which is this one? Where would that be on that, on the big map, you know?
Yes.
Right there?
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, no, I don't. Again, I do not know the vintage of this plan. I do not know whether this is reflective of the most recent delineation that has been reviewed and accepted by the commission. So again, this does show the edge of the property. This also shows that the isolated vegetated wetland area is right on the boundary line, with some of it being on Mr. Carpeno's at 970 and some of it being on 982. Irrespective of that, only 18 feet off of this area still puts you within the jurisdictional 100-foot buffer zone, but it's immaterial because all of that area is zone 2.
So what can he do at this point?
Well, he started to make the appropriate steps, but I just wanted to review for the commission, though, just what this looks like on the site. I'm sorry, it's a little hard to see here, but this is the surface of the ground. These are some saplings and stuff that have been bent over. This is a pile of vegetative root systems, earth, dirt, saplings, and here's the loam stockpile.
Yeah.
That loam stockpile is somewhere in the neighborhood of 20 plus feet high.
Yeah. Okay.
And it's roughly the same proximity to the property boundary that this pile of saplings and trees, which is the one I measured at 18 feet off of that flagged isolated vegetated wetland. So if there's a question of jurisdiction, I just wanted to again say that all of these four lots that I just named are jurisdictional. And we have soil stockpiling, soil management, earth disturbance all occurring, some as near as 20 feet off of that isolated vegetated wetland area. If the commission had received a permit request, the commission would normally have sought to establish a 25-foot, no cut, no disturbance area. When Mr. Aberzauer and I met on the site, I informed him that the material was 18 feet away from that isolated vegetated wetland area, and that we would wish to see a 25-foot separation be established, and that we wanted to see erosion controls put in place to minimize and hopefully prevent any sediment transport entering a regulated wetland resource area, but also heading towards the abutter's property, since, as you can see from that plan,
right,
that's right on the property boundary. So,
could I ask?
Let me have my say. You had your say. Let me have my say. So, I was told that part of the reason for this activity had to do with the rear portion of the lot. Sure that I really captured it, but there's ledge being removed from the parcels.
Now, is that water there?
Yes, there is water in the isolated vegetated. It is ponding water right at this point in time. Somewhere in the area here is where the ledge is being removed. Correct?
Yes.
Yeah. It looks like a pile of gravelly dirt. But I guess the excavator is working at exposing the ledge and trying to peel the dirt off of it so it can be blasted, correct? right? You're gonna blast it to level it, right?
We want to level it, yes.
Yes, okay. So we're blasting or pneumatic or whatever. So, because there isn't, because he's really just doing soils management, I was gonna propose to the commission tonight that you might just consider requiring an after-the-fact request to determine applicability. Even though technically he needs a stormwater management permit, he actually doesn't, I was told, he really doesn't have any planned development in the works for this parcel. So I'm kind of deferring to the commission. Where you have jurisdiction under the wetlands bylaw, and where the riskiest portion of soils management is on this edge of the property within the 100-foot buffer zone of the isolated vegetated wetland area, that maybe just to solve everything and get some written conditions put in place, that an RDA at this point in time might be the best vehicle. Where the gravel is piled up at the rear of the property, I didn't get it.
It's basically all level though, right?
Well as the fact there's like a 40-foot separation between their rear property boundary and where the TOA slope of that gravel pile is, where they're exposing the ledge. And that's been there for a decade, right?
Yeah.
Even more.
Even more. Well, I could only comment because I've only been there about a decade. So.
But I mean, as far as the entire site is pretty down at level.
Yes, that is correct.
So,
but we've got equipment out there. We usually, at a bare minimum, have a condition that requires spill containment materials. We have large erodible stockpiles of soil in relatively close proximity to abutting property line and to vegetated wetland areas. We at a bare minimum would require that proper erosion control be installed and maintained. Mm-hmm. We have the entrance exit activities going out onto the street, which at the time I viewed them were already resulting in just the pickup truck of the equipment operator was pulling material out onto the very heavily traveled Route 133 Haverhill Street. So that being said, I did make the request because I don't have any type of comprehensive plan that shows where these stockpiles are, and therefore where we could specifically say, okay, there needs to be erosion control established from this point to this point. There needs to be the entrance exit pad maintained at this point. In order to get us some type of sketch plan or overall plan, as well as issue a permit that had black and white conditions that would then be enforceable, as well as the RDA will last for 3 years, that I think would put both the property owner and the commission on firm footing as far as understanding what the responsibilities and rules are for this earth-disturbing activity.
And not have to have a stamped plan because there is...
Not have to have a stamped plan. Again, it would be perfectly acceptable for the commission has accepted sort of sketch plans where an assessor's map type thing or whatever then has drawn and located on it where these activities and stockpiles are located.
Right, you made it spin and I got a little confused. Is there some work that has been done within the 25-foot no cut zone? Or did I
Yes. hear something? Yes, when I measured the edge of disturbance, it was 18 feet off of one of those
wetlands. So what are the implications and consequences of that?
Well, it doesn't formally
just that it's recently disturbed material, and before it does any permanent damage, if you move it back, that area will just restore and revegetate, especially where things aren't growing now at this time of year, where the vegetation is still dormant because of the weather conditions, pulling it back will just allow that area to recover.
Okay, I'm just trying to understand, because that's a direct boom.
Well, right.
Just to clarify.
Yeah.
The 25-foot zone does not exist now, phrased in the context of what we normally require.
Because we never got any plans, we never mandated that there be a 25-foot offset. So again, we're backing into this after stuff's been done.
Could I answer this?
Sure.
When Mr. Bezak came and he measured this, we were together, it was 18 feet, as you said. After he told us, we moved it back.
You have,
and it is now 25 to 30 feet.
Okay.
Away from this, and we put the hay bales, or we put socks around this pile here, which is loom, and around this pile, and he told me to put some here, which we did, and we put the stones here. In fact, we did put stones before, but it wasn't enough. We put another truckload here already.
Good.
So we did everything he asked us to do. Thank you.
Okay, so could you draw up some plans, notes on there?
I work for you guys.
No, having your list of conditions is what I call it.
Well, but I'm suggesting that if the commission feels comfortable in my suggested course of action, that you vote tonight to require an after-the-fact request to determine applicability to be filed by April 18th. Hopefully, it would be nice if we could have it for the April 18th meeting, but if we could at least have it by April 18th so we can get an application in the works.
In the meanwhile, he's already done, and have you seen?
No. So there's been no verification. But I know Mr. Abuzara, if he's telling you that that's what they're doing, I'm sure they've been out there and doing it. But that is another reason for me asking for some kind of plan that covers all these lots, so we then can locate and position these things, so we both then can be very clear on where protective measures need to be implemented.
Okay. Would everybody else feel fine with that?
Yes. Are you comfortable with that, filing an after-the-fact RDA?
Determination.
Yes, we would like you to file a request to determine applicability with a plan so that we can cover and we can issue conditions for this earth disturbing activity on your property, or your Saeed's, Jahaz, everybody's property out there, all four lots.
You insist on determination of applicability, or will you just want to a plan to show where everything is?
We've recently been advised by the Department of Environmental Protection that it's best to have some type of permit granting vehicle. We could issue an enforcement order to you if we'd like. That's the other option.
This would be the best way out for you and for us.
There's no fee associated with the filing of an RDA, right?
Correct. I mean, there is payment for. You know, you have to do copying, you have to pay for the notice in the paper and stuff.
But there's no statutory fee associated with that.
You know, this part of it from here on is ABZ storage, which is different from the rest of it.
Right, just as well.
You want only lot 19?
No, we want all four lots where. All four lots where you've got this excavator working and you've got managed piles of soils.
Even if it is ABZ storage?
Yes.
Because
now you have no environmental permit from us, from the commission, to be doing any type of work in the Zone 2.
Okay. The problem is Zone 2.
Yes.
That's a regulated wetland resource area under our bylaw. It's a wetlands.
And there's no grandfather.
No.
Without grandfathers or grandmothers.
No grandfather.
I mean, it is Well, we agree with you, we want everyone to have a clean water to drink.
Well, I hope so. I hope that isn't under any type of.
Somewhere, too.
You know, the town could use a new supermarket.
I'm sorry?
I said the town could use a new supermarket.
We tried before, years ago, we applied. My dear friend, you should have announced it to the whole world, we wanted to do that 10 years ago.
I know that, the planning board disagreed.
And not only you, everyone in town comes and teases us, where is the supermarket, where is the shopping center, everyone.
Try again.
So we're digressing a little bit here, but what I've tried to do, this, basically, this was the best pictometry picture I could get that shows all four of these lots, so we've got one lot here, the very narrow lot, we've got the front lot here, we've got the rear, this jog is part of ABC self-storage. This, you can see the piles of boulders, this is from 2014, so this area back here is where the ledge is being attacked right now. There are piles of soils up here, you can actually see one of the piles of soils that used to be there, it's been moved, and there's now piles of loam and piles of other stuff, the trees and twigs and stuff right here.
You know, let me say, the pile of loam here has been there for more than 10 years.
Yes, but you've moved it. You've all exposed it and you've had a big excavator sitting on top of it, moving it around.
Yeah, it is not my fault, it is the excavator for them. Okay.
So the proposal for a request to determine applicability seems to be the best vehicle to get us quickly there. Yes, it is an option to the commission. If you wish to issue an enforcement order with a directive, you could mandate the same things. And you still, through all of this, do maintain that ability at any time that the permit is not complied with, if and when it is issued. You can still issue an enforcement order. You can still take enforcement action to cure and remediate immediately any violation that occurs on that site.
But
it's just an easier vehicle. Would then give him a 3-year permit to continue his soils management activities until such time as he comes up with a development proposal. But again, that's not
a shopping center.
No, we don't want to go down that road.
Yeah, we can. Okay, so do we need a motion on that?
Need a motion from the commission.
Do I hear such a motion?
Directing the after the fact filing of a request to determine applicability by April 18th.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Brendan, is this yours?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay.
You're welcome.
That's good.
And the date was April 18th, the shooting.
By floor? April 18th.
April 18th.
Okay.
Yep. Got a meeting on March 28th if you want to make it earlier.
Good night.
Yes.
Good night.
Thank you.
That brings us to our 8:15. We're a little behind here. The new notice of violation for 285 Newburyport Turnpike, map 16, parcel lot 4, owned by GTS Realty, LLC, George Soropoulos.
Soropoulos.
Under the Massachusetts Wetland Protection Act, the Town of Raleigh Wetlands Protection Bylaw, possible altering or grading of earth disturbance, depositing soils within 100 feet of a buffer zone bordering vegetated wetlands under the Town of Rowley Stormwater Management and Erosion Control Bylaw. Possible failure to install effective erosion controls after disturbing the earth. Failure to effectively control and prevent sediment from entering the right-of-way and abutting property. The weather was not in your favor.
No.
No.
Almost made it.
Somebody get a little aggressive with the snowplow to it.
Yeah.
Exactly what happened.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
So, apologies for the photographs being taken on Friday, but I was on my way to go to the Dodge Reservation to go out and do trail work. And unfortunately, this image caught my eye. Let me see if I can get it to actually get it increased a little bit. So it looks like it's frosting on the snow pile because it is mostly dirt that apparently was plowed from the adjoining site. And since this time, I have learned that the town actually owns that adjoining property. We apparently took that for a failure to pay taxes.
Oh, you did? Okay. Okay.
So it is town property at this point in time. Okay. Not that helps in you notifying the abutter about the erosion control that you put on there. We know about it. And I'll get the selectman or town administrator up to date. So anyway, so we had vehicle equipment access leaving the site, going on the easement, which is on the town's property now, town easement, as well as an easement for Mass DOT for their highway facility that's in back there. This is looking obviously the back to Newburyport Turnpike, so yes. So we had conditions where there was no appropriate erosion control being used to manage any of the stockpiles of fill on the site, and the equipment was unfortunately tracking in. So upon notification, they pretty much, I think within 48 hours, moved to distribute and get straw wattle in place. The silt fence at first concerned me because it wasn't appropriately installed, and then it was explained to me that that was being used to catch windblown trash from going across the street because the skirt wasn't tucked in. So that's fine. The crushed stone was put down, but we had to correct the little problem of the fact that we surrounded it with the straw wattle, which didn't allow entrance or egress, and now that's been corrected. And we sort of have a situation here, but actually we don't have to get involved in real convoluted discussions about jurisdiction on this one, I don't think. Plan that was previously filed with us for the various addition. I think that's a terrace or something. There's retaining wall, there's a walkway, parking lot was being reconfigured. This plan was filed with our office from the planning board when they requested comments. So here's a delineated bordering vegetated wetlands over on the lot that I've learned now is the town's. Here's the 25-foot easement right of way. I don't think it's all paved, but most of it is paved. The 100-foot buffer zone of the bordering vegetated wetlands extends onto the property and pretty much covers the area in question.
That road little driveway goes back into the family cycling area?
Exactly. Yes, and the Mass DOT maintenance facility. So my recommendation is kind of the same here. If the commission so chooses, I would recommend considering of directing the property owner to file a request to determine applicability. It seems to be plans that we can utilize and sketch on where requirements for erosion control. Oh, I do want to note that apparently there's another egress onto the Newburyport Turnpike up here, which I believe crushed stone was also added to that.
Yeah.
So anyway, so the site management company has got religion, so to speak, in regards to erosion control. And I think, again, the possibility of the commission requiring an after-the-fact request to determine applicability will allow written conditions to be specified and will then keep everybody doing what they should be doing.
Right.
And allow the commission and the property owner to have a written document covering all that earth-disturbing activity. There is also one note that I was told, obviously it's towards the end of the project when this gets repaved, but there's supposed to be a crushed stone infiltration trench installed here to mitigate stormwater, leaving the parking area since there is a gentle slope.
And what we're planning to do is not repave it. We're going to seal it and restripe it.
Oh, okay.
Intentionally, so that we're not disrupting that area. That'll get cut in at the end just because there is a lot of vehicle work going over it. It doesn't make sense to put it in and then silt it up. So that'll be one of the sort of tail end site work pieces that we do.
Well, and I was asked originally why the commission, why the department, didn't make any specific focused comment about the need to file ahead of time. And that's because the plan submitted to us really only showed this work and realignment of the parking area with all this other proposed foundation work in addition outside our jurisdictional area.
Yeah.
So the commission in the past, and I would have certainly advised the commission, we don't normally require a permit for just paving an existing parking area if that was going to be all that was going to be done.
Well, if you had more room there, you wouldn't even, notice it, but to work it
out.
Sure.
Yeah. Well, I think there just, there wasn't any recognition on my part that there would be so much soil stockpiling and everything else.
And like you said, the plow, who George has contracted with separately than the contractor that's doing the project, had, tried to get snow out of the way, went across the street, which I think he's probably historically done, and that's what it was.
I was on vacation that week.
You were away.
My foreman was on vacation that week. So
I got a phone call, and I went down there, and Brendan called me, and it was just classic mess.
Yep.
Well, I came back on Friday, I expected a phone call. So
yep.
All right, so you can live with that. If,
yeah, we're fine.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Do I? Yes.
And just as a point of interest, I was in Spud's last Thursday night, which is on this side of the wet swamp that's at the bottom of that diagram.
Down off of.
And that was at 10 o'clock at night at the tail end of that warm spell we had, and I heard one spring peeper in that swamp.
Boy, that's early.
Yes, I heard one spring peeper out at Dodge Reservation that Sunday.
All right, do we need a motion to?
Yes, please.
Well, here's such a motion.
So moved.
Second? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Good.
Aye. Same date?
Yes.
Yeah. By April 18th.
Yeah.
Stormwater management issue.
Mm-hmm.
I believe in this situation, this request to determine applicability will address the stormwater management issues. This project is not a 20,000 square foot disturbance project, but the lack of erosion controls, again, going into a right-of-way, going into a wetland resource area, or going onto a budding property, we almost got all three of those on this one that, again, triggers that particular bylaw. But as long as the commission's comfortable that the RDA will satisfy both bylaw requirements, we'll proceed in that direction. To
If it had been done in August, it wouldn't even have rose its head. You know?
Yeah, but we're happy to deal with it.
And I'm sorry, your name, sir?
I'm Jonathan. I'm the architect.
Okay.
What are you going to do in that building?
Software development.
The world needs lots of that.
Yes.
That's it.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, guys.
Take care.
All right, you know, so whoever you end up actually giving the assignment of preparing the request for determination applicability.
Yep.
You know, you call me, we've got a checklist on the website or whatever, so.
I'll give Tom and Dan a call.
Oh, okay.
And do that with Tom.
Okay. That'd be good, because I think he's got the plans already and he's familiar with the process.
Perfect.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you so
Thank
much.
You.
Thank you, gentlemen.
You remember?
Who moved?
I did.
Yep.
Howard.
Thank you.
That brings us to a certificate of completion request.
Lucy, hi there.
A new request for a certificate of completion, SMP number 11-2014 for 320 Weathersfield Street, map 18, parcel 5, lot 22-3, Anthony Gavalisi.
Gravelisi.
Gravelisi of AG Construction. Go ahead.
Well, he's pretty much all set. Except I'm sure he saw my email today, as I'm hoping you did.
Yeah, I did.
So we just have two minor things to take care of on the site. There is a memo to the commission on this one. So for the certificate of completion, Raleigh Conservation Commission office is in receipt of a request for a certificate of completion accompanied by a plan titled Site As-Built Plan at 320 Weathersfield Street in Raleigh, Mass., dated January 16th, 2017, and a letter from Mr. Vernon J. LeBlanc, P.E., confirming compliance with the issued stormwater management permit number 11-2014. A field inspection was conducted on March 7th, 2017. The field inspection identified two remaining minor issues to be rectified before final issuance of the complete certificate of completion. One, removal and proper disposal of remaining sections of straw wattle along the toe slope of the subsurface sewage disposal system mound. Number two, the addition of crushed stone to provide a stable velocity reduction discharge pad at the outlet of the foundation drain that daylights in roughly the same
place. Yeah, we did the same thing with the other drain on 314.
Exactly. Yep. The issued order contains the following ongoing conditions. Number 43, maintenance of roof runoff infiltration system, including gutters and downspouts. Number 44, maintenance of supporting drainage systems and driveway crushed stone infiltration trenches. Number 45, prohibiting the use of sodium chloride rock salt for ice control. And number 46, allowed use of more environmentally friendly ice melting chemicals. Commission may wish to consider the issuance of a complete certificate of completion upon field verification of the two listed minor tasks being done with the ongoing conditions listed above.
Do I hear such a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Is that it? Unanimous?
Yep.
Great. Hey, you get to sign something tonight, finally.
Well, you signed a plan of bills.
Well, yeah.
Says bills, yeah. That's right. Probably get to sign those.
Yeah, Ben, I'll hopefully be up there. If not, this end of this week, I'll be up there first thing, probably Monday, and I'll get rid of that. As you know, it's no big deal to your fiddles. I have a little piece of straw.
Yeah, I'll do a little cell phone picture of the crushed stone and just do another picture where that is, just looking down slope, because I know the straw wattle was right there, just showing me that the wattle's gone.
No problem. Easy.
Brent, where is it?
Pardon me?
Where's 320?
Do you remember Sandy Patrickin's common driveway that went into the three lots?
It's those?
Yep.
Oh, okay.
Yep, this is the third and final lot of three lot project.
Has the third house been sold yet? No, not yet. I put it on in the fall, so kind of a bad time. So I'm hoping now with spring coming.
Oh, you had a couple open houses there.
Yeah.
What are you asking for?
It's up for $699. The second one
the middle house, 316, they actually resold already. The original homeowner ended up moving with her daughter. She was sick or something like that. Resold that for 704 or something like that. Yeah, so I shouldn't have a problem.
Yeah.
What did the first one go for?
First one went for 690. So, first one's always the hardest too, right?
I guess.
It is. Alright, so I'm all set?
All right. You're all set?
Alright, yeah. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Okay.
This brings us to our next item, which is a open meeting law complaint. Open meeting law complaint filed by Stephen Conley Sr., received by the town clerk February 27th, 2017. Review the response to the February 14th letter from Stephen Conley Sr. of We the People in reference to the above complaint. So, Brent, why don't you take over right here, because you were the one that...
So the first, there's kind of two items here. The first item is going to be the commission's response to the open meeting law complaint. So there's a proscribed method, which I believe when I emailed you folks a PDF of the submittal to us, I included instructions so that the commission, so the instructions for the public body, now public body refers to board, commission, etc., that receives the complaint, the chair must disseminate the complaint to the members of the public body. So Chairman Page directed me to send you folks that PDF scan of all the information that we received. The public body must meet to review the complaint within 14 business days. The complaint actually directly addressed to Chairman Page and the Conservation Commission was received on March 1st, so we are fulfilling the obligation of meeting within 14 business days. After review, but within 14 business days, the public body must respond to the complaint in writing and must send the Attorney General a copy of the complaint and a description of any action the public body has taken to address it. At the same time, the public body must send the complainant a copy of its response. The public body may delegate this responsibility to counsel or staff member, but only after it has met to review the complaint. Then the final thing was if you needed more time, but we don't need more time. So I was directed to confer with Debbie Egan, town administrator, and before you is a proposed response if the commission will choose to accept it. Basically, it reviews, now there's a form, there's a proscribed two-page form on the Attorney General's website that has to be used per the rules of the Attorney General's office that needs to be used for this complaint. That was scanned and that was sent to you. This is responding directly to the information that was filled out on that form. Okay. So, do you want me to read the whole thing?
I think everybody can read it to themselves.
If you have any questions, but basically the core... The sort of things that do not make sense in this is, number one, that the town of Rowley is named as the public body, which the town is not. Mr. Brent Bazelak, me, is alleged to have committed the violation, but I am not a public body or a member of the public body. I am
just
an agent. I'm an employee, not an appointed member of the commission, who is the public body. And then January 23rd and January 25th, were put down as dates of the alleged violation, but our meeting was on January 24th. Now, to have a violation of the open meeting law, you kind of need to have done something wrong in your open meeting. We did not have any type of meeting on the 23rd or the 25th.
Um,
So that is the reason for the response.
Yep, I have already read this earlier, and I think the response is very good. I'm a little troubled as to why we even have to go through this, but...
Well, because we received that complaint from...
Right, no, I mean, but...
In the prescribed manner.
Yeah, it's like providing documents. It's the public, sorry to hear that.
There's a typo on the first page. The last paragraph says the attached statement of 2/14/17 with E closures, it should be M closures.
No, it should not. It's a direct quote as to how Mr. Stephen Conley Sr. filled out the form.
Oh, okay, so the typo was in his...
Yep.
That's
why it's in quotes, right?
Right, yes.
Ignoring the fact that obviously everything is off balance because of these issues, I was still confused as to what the complaint was.
Well, we'll...
And we can talk...
We'll be talking about that in a minute.
So what do you need is an agreement that we...
Just whether we have to respond.
You need to respond.
And if this is, you all have a copy of it, and we need to sign it and send that in. If, you know, each of us gets to...
Well, we need a motion to...
A motion to accept it.
To support this as the response to the open meeting law complaint.
So moved.
All right, shouldn't, if we're going to get into something later on, why...
No, we've got the February 14th letter to take care of.
And we're dealing with...
We're dealing with the open law.
This is the response.
This is item one under the open meeting law.
Yes.
There's two issues there.
Yes.
Incorrect.
I'm sorry?
Basically, this says the form is incorrect.
It's hard to know what was intended based on the information that was filled out. But we believe...
I'll agree with you.
We think we know...
Basically...
Yeah. Yes.
What does constitute a public body?
Board, commission.
I guess we're looking at it.
Yeah.
Yeah. The packet was mailed to Chairman Arthur Page and to the Raleigh Conservation Commission.
Now, I can actually meet with two other members, correct? Three of us can get together and it's...
Right. But we've got... A motion's been made...
Yes.
By Commissioner Vogel.
I'll second it. All those in favor? This response?
We need to sign this. Put one copy around.
Yeah, this one.
Does it have to be in blue ink?
I'm sorry?
Does it have to be in blue ink or...
You get whatever your pen's got. Okay, the next item is at the commission's last meeting during Mr. Conley Sr.'s visit. Yeah, attendance, agenda item, and addressing the commission. He submitted a three-page letter, which also ended up being attached and included as part of the documentation for the open meeting law complaint. So Secretary Deborah Cunningham and myself conferred at the direction of Chairman Page to craft a response. We also sought input from Town Administrator Deborah Egan. And this copy of the letter that I just handed to you is, as best we can fathom, a point-by-point response to all the questions that Mr. Conley Sr. Raised in his three-page letter to the commission. And just for your, since he raised details about a specific agenda posting, you will find that we are responding to that on the first page. On the questions that start on page two, you'll see item number two actually responds directly to his concern that the revised meeting agenda for January 24th, which was sent to the town clerk at 2:13, but the town clerk's office was not staffed at 2:13 p.m. And so the town clerk did not receive, stamp that agenda in until the next day after the meeting had already occurred. But the two items that were revised on that agenda, one of them was an announcement of the conference, and the second revised item, which were clearly noted with asterisks, the second item that was added to that agenda, that had to do with talking about the working group that the town of Essex wanted to convene on working on docks and piers. So those, per the Attorney General's guidance, those were not clearly anticipated prior to 48 hours prior to the meeting, but they were added. The agendas, as you see, are placed on the chairs for the audience. The agenda was also posted right outside the Conservation Office meeting room, as well as the Attorney General's guidance is if an item is not subject to deliberation or public input or conflict or whatever, that
can be brought up.
Yeah, so we believe we did not commit any infraction of the open meeting law, but obviously that, you know, if and when we get a complaint and it goes to the AG's office, it will be reviewed.
Anybody have any questions on my response?
I've got a bit of a problem because I'm reading responses to questions that I don't remember. Okay. I recognize that.
Would you like me, would you like me to review the questions?
Either that or else, sure. If I can read them.
We were originally handed those.
I'm not questioning. You know what? I was going to say, I have it too. So
I have it right here.
I don't need it read. If someone else wants it read, they can.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
You're all set with that?
Everybody had the chance to review the... Anybody have a problem with me signing that as a response?
I don't see anything to change.
No? Did we make a motion to...
Yeah. Move to issue the response.
May I have such a motion? To respond to this?
I would just note that I wasn't at the meeting on February 14th, but these materials were distributed to me, and I have reviewed them, and I have reviewed this letter, and I will make that motion.
Second?
Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.
And that brings us to status.
Status report. So, Prospect Hill Access Roadway Project at 124 Google Street. Project is being inspected and monitored, especially after any weather events, as stated. And that was most recently inspected, I believe, on last week, I think. Monday or Tuesday of last week, I stopped at the site, and we haven't had any rainfall, and the rainfall today was been relatively insignificant, so I honestly haven't stopped.
I really wish we'd actually get a little bit more rain, because being a gravel hill, it's turning into sand, you know?
Yeah.
That work was not done by Pat, by the highway, you know. Ford actually sent people down here that afternoon.
Right.
Did all that, yeah.
Right, well, that's why T. Ford is the only party that's mentioned about doing work on the erosion.
No, I wanted to thank the highway, and they informed me that the T. Ford beat them.
Okay, so that's, so the status report is the project is still stable with functioning erosion controls appropriately in place, and no signs of any movement or issues of any sediment.
Project comment requests.
Yeah, well, the planning board asked for comments from various departments. The planning board is having their first meeting that will have the 305 Newburyport Turnpike Prime Realty project. And I just wanted to update the commission. The planning board has engaged the services of H.L. Graham to perform the technical review. And let's see. And Mr. Graham contacted me to assess how the commission felt about the amount.
Where that is, again, that's the place that's torn up right now?
Yes, it has the screening fence on it, just as you're going up over the rise, past the Mexican restaurant and variety store, so.
Screen fence has caved towards the building.
Yes, it has.
Yeah.
The ground's frozen, you can't get there.
So to just review for the commission, the proposal that we first saw was parking area and this large area of wetlands being filled. So Mr. Graham has suggested, because the planning board has oversight over number of parking spaces for the square footage of, there's more zoning rules and regulations about that. And Mr. Graham has made, very nicely, kind of a little extra effort on his part, made a conceptual sketch to frame the discussion with the planning board members tomorrow night that reduces the amount of wetlands filling and just provides a travel corridor here to get to these parking spaces removed from the building. Now, remember, our regulations under the Wetlands Protection Act have a hierarchy where, for wetlands fillings, the first thing is we try to avoid any wetlands filling.
Right.
The second thing is, if filling is unavoidable, then you try to mitigate and minimize it as much as possible. And then the third thing is, if you do have to fill, you replicate, mm-hmm. so that you recreate the wetlands that has been lost due to the filling. So Mr. Graham has, using his engineering skills and his knowledge of the planning board rules and regulations, has proposed a possible concept for the planning board and the applicant to consider in the planning board's meeting tomorrow night.
Mm-hmm. I think it's excellent.
Can I ask a couple questions?
Well, of course.
First of all, has he reduced the number of parking spaces?
Looks like he has.
Yes.
If you look at the other plan here.
That was my guess. It's rather far away from me.
Yeah.
Not that I'm complaining.
He has reduced the number of spaces.
Okay.
This plan doesn't exactly have a specific numbering or a table that I can see about
bigger
the spaces, but 12 and 11 here and 1, 2.
Okay, you're above 12 and
11. Oh, yeah,
19.
Okay. Yeah, so I'm up to, okay. I've got 9 more just in this row.
Okay.
So maybe the reduction is about 16 or 10. So
what's the overall distance that people walk? That actually, I guess it isn't really changing, except that
there's no more places close to the building.
Yeah.
And now they all
well,
have
to there
walk
are a few,
over.
But
now
most
of them are farther away. But that's where he had some
of
the
what's the depth of that lot, Brent?
I'm sorry?
What is the depth of that lot? I'm not asking exact, I'm asking.
You want from the frontage, or do you want back
building.
Here
from the,
from the building? From the building, the furthest space on a 30 scale, 1 inch equals 30, is 220 feet.
Okay.
So this.
That's not unreasonably.
This requires someone to walk an additional 70 feet. From this spot to this spot.
Well, actually, those people just don't exist at this point. But yeah.
Well, yeah. I just meant.
I know.
The first people who get to occupy the closest parking spaces, assuming that the employees are probably required to park back here, and if they do have retail customers, they would probably be directed to be parking up there.
Yeah.
So, assuming it's the employees, kind of like we do here, where we now all park in the new parking area, so we can let the seniors have the spaces closest.
Fresh memory, has this been with not that plan, but has this all planned before us before? I think I remember something like this, right?
No.
What have we had before us?
We had one. We had a building out there where they were putting a tank, tight tank in. But that was,
yeah, it's just big glass on
yeah,
the
yeah, but we've never seen this.
I'm sorry.
Yes, here. This building right down here.
So this is the first time this is anything about this is coming to us.
No, this is the first time since you've been on the board that it's coming to us.
That's what I mean. Yeah. Okay, that's what I'm saying. I don't remember anything about
they this. Had an existing order of conditions that had a landscape storage gravel yard in the back here. And with the building up here. And they've reconfigured something or they've done something different with the septic system capacity that gives them the ability
to
have a different utilization.
I like this. Yeah, this was a lot of planning went into that.
Yeah. So So anyway, and he got caught with his order of conditions expired.
And they keep it perfectly contained.
This would have been a project amendment anyway, because it's such a change.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, I just, I'm trying to draw perspective.
I don't know how they mow it, actually. On that building, if you drive past it, like going towards Newbury Board, heading north, and you see that they have a water retention system down there. It's beautiful. I mean, it's engineering marvel. And it's very well maintained, but I don't know how they mow it.
It's pretty speed.
This guy started doing work before, I mean, this stuff, there's foundations in there.
Yeah, oh yeah.
He had a permit.
He had a permit.
He had an existing order of conditions.
I got you.
Again, it was allowed to expire, but he also wanted to amend things and change things. So we're just doing it with a new order. Because once they expire, you can't resurrect them, only the legislature can.
So what are you going to tell the, that we were fine with this?
Well, at this point in time, I was just going to kind of offer the perspective to the planning board that if there is an option under consideration that reduces the amount of filling, that the commission is supportive of that effort.
Strongly.
But there's a whole bunch of other planning board zoning things going on here. Actually, Mr. Surratt came in and spoke to me this afternoon because he was kind of upset about it. And I said, well, I said, again, I said, one of the reasons we wanted you to go to planning was so that these kind of things could get worked out with the planning board, because the Conservation Commission is not so, doesn't have so many rules and regulations about parking spaces and usage and all that stuff.
But that, this kind of thing would be an improvement to that piece of land.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But I mean, it would, look at it now,
it would be nice if we didn't have so many square feet of the wetlands impacted just for the sake of a few parking spaces.
Yes.
I mean, ultimately, but again. So I was just going to kind of offer that general comment on behalf of the commission.
Was there anything else on the docket tonight?
No.
That last item, items that could not be reasonably anticipated?
That will disappear. That will be the last time we have that on the agenda.
Why is that?
Because...
We're unlikely.
Well, but the commission's past practice and the advice coming from the town administrator's office is that it's really best if we continue the practice of having someone submit a request in writing so that the commission and the chair has an opportunity to measure its appropriateness and also any type of backup research or something needs to be done.
Because we're a regulatory.
Because we're a regulatory board.
One of my first meetings as chairman, we entertained something from the floor and we actually got spoken to.
Well.
Because it's.
We had Mr. Sabatini and the Hain.
That's right. I'm trying to think of what it was, but yeah.
And the Hain request or whatever.
Then I was in downtown hall and Debbie Heaton said, don't open that door.
So as part of open meeting, it should be on the agenda.
Well, we're a regulatory board. We want to have it.
Things should be on the agenda.
Yes.
Unless something comes up as an emergency.
Unless there's an emergency.
Yeah. But here, you have to remember that the commission's decision making is driven by a framework of rules and regulations. It's not just a question of, the gazebo on your open space property, what color do you want it painted next week or whatever? I mean, that's hardly ever what anybody wants to talk to us about. So we usually have to do some kind of research for decision making. Water department, cutting the trees along Pingree Farm Road. Without having the opportunity to research and find out that there was a conservation restriction, we could have, you could misspeak. In your effort to try and give someone an answer that night, which all of us try to help someone out, but if we make a decision and we don't follow the framework of rules and regulations, we can get ourselves into an issue where we inadvertently give somebody the impression that they can do something that actually is not appropriately allowed.
Okay.
Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We're done.
The time is 9:10.